Hey, everybody. I'm Amna Nawaz, national correspondent and substitute anchor for the PBS NewsHour. So your regularly programmed podcast will show up in your podcast feed soon. But this morning, we want to give you a little something extra, a very special edition episode on the State of the Union from last night. Stick around right now for everything you love about the PBS NewsHour. Great analysis, sharp conversation, and some really smart takeaways you won't get anywhere else. So you probably caught that speech last night, something we call the State of the Union. Maybe you've heard of it. We had the president. We had the former Democratic candidate for governor in Georgia. That's Stacey Abrams. It was a whole thing. You probably already heard about the speeches and the fanfare, but we're here to tell you what really mattered. What parts of what you heard were just political rhetoric, and what parts will actually matter to you in the long run. Helping me make sense of all of this are my amazing NewsHour colleagues. We're going to start off right now with our White House correspondent, Yamiche Alcindor. How you doing, Yamiche?
I'm doing okay. It was a long speech. It's a very long speech.
It's a long speech. It's been a long day. Yamiche just ran over here from the White House after covering the speech. But here's what we're going to try to do is separate what matters from what was just chat. What stood out to you as something that you think really, really matters from what the president said?
What stood out to me is that a shutdown could still happen. The president sounded like he was kicking off his 2020 campaign. And in a lot of ways, he said, you know what? I'm not compromising on the wall. Walls save lives. He even made up a couple facts and said, hey, the new wall in San Diego and El Paso, that's really stopping crime and helping people. What we really know is that there is no new wall in San Diego. The only thing that's been approved is fixing fences that other administrations already put in place. So in some ways, what we saw was a president sticking to his guns, doubling down while saying, hey, I am happy that there are some women in Congress, but let's get back to business, which is Democrats don't really understand border security, and I do.
It's interesting that we didn't hear him mention the word shutdown once, right?
Yeah. He didn't mention the word shutdown, but if you're listening clearly and you realize that the shutdown was because he wanted a border wall and $5.7 billion, what you heard was the president saying, I'm not compromising on that. And the president and the White House had been saying this is going to be a unifying message. But there was a key moment there. It was almost something that made me chuckle a little bit. The president says the state of our union is strong. Mm-hmm. Mike Pence starts clapping. Republicans go wild. They're chanting USA, USA. Nancy Pelosi's flipping through papers saying, yeah, no, I'm not clapping for that.
I did not hear that.
And it reminded me that the state of our union is what we see before our eyes, mm-hmm. that this is the state of our union is divided, that people are not on the same page, and this president is not on the same page as Democrats.
You mentioned the border wall and the funding and the fight over that is still very much going on. Immigration is clearly, it's a centerpiece, right, of everything this president's been fighting for in recent months and what we think he's going to keep fighting for moving forward. So what did you hear in there in the way of immigration that you think could actually be a place where they do start to come together, or was most of it just rhetoric?
Most of it was not rhetoric as much as it was him staking his claim to his positions, and they're just completely different than what Democrats believe. He was highlighting the fact that essentially he thinks undocumented immigrants are criminals, and that's something that the Democrats have said that's not true. And Stacey Abrams, in her response, said immigrants are part of the American fabric. Their children should not be in cages. And that's a big difference that the president laid out and the Democrats laid out. And I just don't see how these two sides come together and say, yeah, we can agree on something.
So, you know, one of the things that stood out was there was a lot of new ground tread by the president, too, in some initiatives we haven't heard him really talk about before. I wonder how many of those you think will actually become real things, right? There was like the infrastructure spending. We know we've talked about that before. There was nationwide family leave. There was a pledge to end AIDS in America. Are those just ideas, or are we going to see something now?
I think Democrats are under their own political pressure to show that once they have control of Congress, that they too can pass laws, that they too can get something done. So I think after we saw the First Step Act pass, that criminal justice reform bill that both Democrats and Republicans rallied around, I think that there's an opening there for another kind of bipartisan legislation. And healthcare has always been the big thing where Democrats and Republicans, they can agree that healthcare costs too much. Mm-hmm. They can agree that there should be something done more on HIV and AIDS. They can agree on the fact that pharmaceutical companies probably have too much control and too much power in American society. So it would be surprising to see Democrats and Republicans come together, but I don't think it's off the table.
So I should also ask you, before we let you go, because I know you've got more reporting to do, Stacey Abrams delivering the Democratic response there. She really did hit back directly at some of what the president said, but she also kind of went into other territory there. What did you make of the way that she responded?
Well, I think first to talk about optics, there was the optics going on inside the House chamber where you have all these women, all these diversity on the Democratic side, and essentially a lot of old white men on the Republican side. Facts, not things that I'm making up. And then you see Stacey Abrams. She's someone who's not holding an elected office, who's an African-American woman, who's delivering the State of the Union response. And just in her presence, it tells you the Democrats are saying, we're not going to just talk about diversity. We're going to take it seriously. And then Stacey Abrams said a couple of things that were really important. She said, the president, we just need you to tell the truth. And we want to also talk about voter suppression. And we want to talk about not having kids in cages. Those three points to me got to the heart of what Democrats are talking about. Because what we see in the gridlock that we see in Washington, a lot of it is because they just can't agree on the facts. They can't even start a conversation because they just don't believe the same things.
So I got to ask you this, too. A lot of times coming out of these speeches, there's like a meme at the end of the day, right? There's somebody falling asleep in the background or somebody drinking a sip of water. I'm not naming names here, but we all know who we're talking about. Who is there anything from this night that you think stands out as like, oh, people are going to be talking about this?
Yeah, I think people are going to be talking about the fact that Mike Pence is clapping while Nancy Pelosi is shuffling through her printed copy of the speech, wondering when is this going to end? Because this was a long, long speech. I know I said that at the beginning, but this was almost record-setting. I think we're going to have to go look at the numbers, but if it was over an hour and 29 minutes, he beat the record for State of the Union speeches, which is just exhausting.
We'll go to the numbers and we'll let y'all know. Yamiche Alcindor, our White House correspondent. Thanks for stopping by.
Thanks.
And joining us in the studio right now, fresh off some traffic here in the Washington, D.C. area, our congressional correspondent, Lisa Desjardins, and our digital politics editor and senior writer, Dan Bush. How bad was the traffic, guys?
You know, well, the first problem was like that the security at the Capitol actually had locked the door to where our car was.
No.
But it's all right. It all worked out fine. We're glad to be here.
We made it.
You made it. You made it indeed. And you guys were there on the Hill, right? Dan, you were actually in the chamber for this speech. What we're trying to do in this conversation is let folks out there know, okay, what was just rhetoric and what really matters? So Lisa, kick us off here. Okay. What did you hear in there? What stood out to you as something the president mentioned that could really matter in the long run?
Yeah, I think the long run is the thing. I was hoping there would be things that mattered, this week, because we have a potential government shutdown coming. But in that section of the speech, actually, the president didn't really change his kind of hard-to-define position. But, you know, I think that in the long run, he was really trying to reach out to his opponents or those who see him as very partisan. He began the whole speech with this whole riff on we need to put country over party,
right?
You know, which is a classic statesman, big president thing to say. It's something that Barack Obama got a lot of credit for. You go all about JFK. You know, so I think that he wanted that to matter. But the problem is the speech had so many kind of hand grenades that he was lobbing at Democrats alongside with those things he was reaching out with, that they kind of cancel each other out. And if he was trying to, as I think he was, and Republicans after the speech told me, they really think he was trying to be more unifying. I don't know if his words will matter because at the same time, he was intensely partisan and sharply kind of attacking of Democrats in other areas.
So which is going to matter more, right? The words are what actually happens next. What about you, Dan? What stood out to you?
I mean, this is all about optics and perception and the political theater, the pomp and circumstance, right? It's a night that Washington does really well. Everybody shows up. They're all in one space. And if we focus on the politics, this is a president who came in talking about a message of unity, right? But everybody in the chamber, you could just see the animosity, the hostility dripping from both sides. Democrats who didn't stand up for anything except for, you know, cheering on veterans and cancer research. And when you know that Democrats are not standing for anything except for cancer research.
And ending HIV,
right?
So And women in Congress.
Then you know there's some real anger on both sides, which ran completely counter, right, to the message that Trump was talking about tonight.
You do not think this was a message of unity?
And that's what he was going for.
So let's talk about something that you hinted at earlier, which is some of the long form or like long term compromise, if you'd even go so far to call it a compromise, right? He spent a lot of time on immigration. The fight over immigration is what got us to this delayed State of the Union in the first place. Was there anything in there you think Democrats can grab onto? Any hint of what's ahead?
You know, in a way, that's why I wanted to have that to point to as something that mattered, because the first thing that's going to happen already this week, you know, at 10 a.m., the day after the State of the Union, we're going to have a conference committee meeting on border security.
Right.
And everyone, Republicans, Democrats on the conference committee, was listening to this speech to see,
These are the lawmakers trying to figure it out, right?
They're trying to come up with a deal, right? And so what they were waiting for the president to indicate, oh, is this going to be harder or easier than we thought? And I think he actually didn't move the needle at all. There was one moment where you could actually say maybe he moved it back a little bit. He added language to the speech, Amna, that was not in the prepared remarks, where he said, this body has supported or funded building walls before, but they didn't get built. And he said, I will build the wall. I will build it. Now, first of all, that's not accurate because it was specifically fencing that they supported. But I think he sort of stayed in this weird gray zone that is not helpful to Congress of, I want more border security. I think it's a huge crisis. And I guess you could say the one way that he offered an olive branch was he made a very definitive statement that legal immigration is helpful and important to this nation and to who we are. I've never heard him say it in such a strong way before.
There was another thing he mentioned. I think some people were surprised he even mentioned at all, and that was the investigations. Mm. It was sort of a throwaway line to some degree, but he basically said, we have a great economy, we have to protect our national security. Both of these things could go up in flames because of partisan investigations. Is that a real anything that we need to pay attention to, or is he just doing the same thing he's always done?
It's an interesting line to focus on because it was the one moment in the speech where we really saw the president alluding to the elephant in the room, these investigations both on Capitol Hill and the special counsel investigation. He mentioned it just once in passing. And I spoke to Senator Chris Coons of Delaware after the speech, and he said that he felt a distinct chill in the room. And sitting in the chamber, you could see that. Coons was right. When he referred to the ridiculous investigations, as he called it, Republicans reacted sort of stone-faced, Democrats did too. Nobody really seemed to like him.
They're cheering him on. Yeah.
Nobody was cheering
him
on.
Nobody wanted to react to
this. Nobody wanted to touch that at all. Yeah. And it goes to show how, on the Republican side, nervous the party is about, you know, where this will lead us. And Democrats are sort of watching this potential threat, political, legal threat to President Donald Trump, and they don't want to step in quite yet. They want to let it take its course. But as the senator said, it really was a moment where you could hear the pin drop.
Go ahead. Well, I was gonna say, but this is where I kind of do see like long-term things that might matter, or at least are revealing about where he's going directionally. Like that line was, so he said, if there is going to be peace and legislation, there cannot be war and investigation.
It's a good bit of rhyming.
It was a good bit of rhyming. But the idea that he's saying, okay, war and peace, those are opposite. But he's also saying here, legislation and investigation are opposite.
And like one will prevent the other.
One will prevent the other, right. And so, and he is actually a legislative force himself. And so, I don't know that you could say it's a veiled threat, right?
Okay, yeah.
So he was laying down some markers that were more aggressive about the way he's going to handle his job and the way he's going to handle policy on everything from immigration to abortion to these investigations.
So here's a couple of other things that he hinted at in what we could call like new territory, although some of it we've talked about before and it never really got off the ground. Infrastructure spending was one. He talked about it in the last State of the Union. Is that fertile ground that could be walked in the days ahead?
We were just in a traffic jam. All Americans everywhere run into potholes. It's something that...
You're like, I have a very specific story.
I have a very specific story. It literally just happened to me tonight. But it's something that all Americans connect to, right? President Trump trotted it out in 2018 in his State of the Union saying, Democrats, Republicans, let's come together and do this. It didn't happen. He trotted out again this year as the one policy issue where Democrats and Republicans can agree. And they do. They both agree on the need for infrastructure investment, but there has been a long-term disagreement among Democrats and Republicans about how to pay for it. Democrats want to raise the gasoline tax. Republicans do not want to raise the gas tax to pay for this. So while there is sort of general superficial agreement, it's still the same old partisan divide on how to actually get something done.
So much cynicism over here from Dan Bush.
Oh, he hasn't even started, actually. I feel like infrastructure is like the big box of Twinkies in your closet that you're like, oh, we're going to eat those Twinkies someday. You know, and then there's always some reason that you're like, no, I'm not going to eat them now.
Yeah.
It's not, like, it's weird, and it just sits there for timelessly.
I mean,
just,
they do last a really long time, though.
So
they can sit there. They can sit there as long as you want them to. Here's another thing I want to ask you about, though, and I think I'm assuming a lot here based on previous reporting, but I think this is one of Ivanka's signature pushes, right, which is nationwide family leave. He did mention it. Is that a potential? I mean, everyone can get behind that, right? Is that a potential thing we could see? Is that real?
It is real, but again, it is the same issue. How do you pay for it? You know, you hit on the exact two issues. I talked to Colin Allred, who's a freshman Democrat from Texas and really interesting member. And those are the two things he mentioned. He said, yeah, I am all on board infrastructure. We need that. And paid family leave, yes. But it doesn't seem that there's the willpower now to get there because there's these bigger mountains of issues like border security that they have to deal with first.
You think until they get those big things done, they won't be able to do these other things?
Yeah, I think until they get them done or acknowledge that they just, until this whole funding fight gets off the table. And unfortunately, the way things are stacked, once this funding fight is done, there's another funding fight for this coming September. So it's hard to see, I hate to say, but it's hard to see this fertile ground again, like getting, or these Twinkies are staying on the shelf.
These Twinkies,
I would just add to that quickly, you know, the paid family leave issue gets at this interesting thing for me, which I saw in the speech. It reminded me of the way that Trump approaches these issues because he's not a conservative ideologue, right? Mm-hmm. We look back to the election in 2016 and there's a lot of questions about how conservative is he really.
Right.
You go through this speech, and there are policy proposals in there which we could imagine a Democrat saying, right? Whether it's paid family leave, whether it's really stepping out and championing and supporting criminal justice reform, or even foreign policy. It struck me when he was talking about ending foreign wars, which is something he campaigned on, right? And he said at one point, we do not know whether we will achieve an agreement. This is on a negotiated peace in Afghanistan, but we do know that after two decades of war, the hour has come to at least try for peace. And then he added that he knows the other side would like to do the same thing. It reminded me of when President Obama, when he was a candidate in 2008, being criticized for saying that he would sit down and negotiate with his rivals, with adversaries. And so it's interesting. Some of the things he's trotting out here are not things that Republicans typically support, and yet they were standing up and cheering him tonight.
Well, so that brings me to our final point here, which is a lot of people are saying this is a lot of messaging about what we're going to be seeing in 2020, right? Mm-hmm. That this is sort of laying the groundwork for some of the points he may be making in the future. And then you had the Democratic response, and you have Stacey Abrams. You have the first Black woman to deliver that response. You have all of the optics in comparing those two. And you had Stacey Abrams mentioning what has been a signature issue for her, right, which is voter suppression and expanding voting rights. How much of a battleground is that going to be? Will that be something we see a lot of action on in the days ahead?
That's a massive battleground. It's a battleground in the courts. It's a battleground on local election boards. It is a massive front, and it is something where there are both sides are putting a lot of money into lawyers and into on-the-ground work. Now, it's a battleground in terms of changing how the rules work. You know, I don't know if it activates voters in the way that it activates leaders, I think, who see a problem in their communities being voters being suppressed, like Stacey Abrams. So I think it will matter in that we're at a point where that fight and whose vote is taken seriously and who has to go through more hoops to vote is being determined. But I don't think that is going to be the number one, 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 top issue in 2020 in terms of what's put out to voters. I don't know. Dan, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree. And I think also on top of that, you know, we think about the response and the focus on voting rights from Stacey Abrams and the official response outside of the chamber. But then there was the response inside the chamber from the Democrats who have already announced that they're running or announced that they've formed exploratory committees, the first step. And from my view, in the second row of the press gallery, I had a clear look at Cory Booker, Kamala Harris, Elizabeth Warren, and Kirsten Gillibrand, all top high-profile Democrats who have announced. And they all had very different responses and reactions to President Trump. Kamala Harris had a look of bemused frustration. She had a smile on her face the whole time. She seemed to take a lot of what Donald Trump said with a look of pure confusion. Cory Booker just looked pretty frustrated. He never cracked a smile. Kirsten Gillibrand stood up and clapped more than the other ones, and Elizabeth Warren stone-faced the whole time. So you could see them all sort of looking at each other in the chamber and saying, "Who is Elizabeth Warren standing up?" They're already staking
right on the spectrum.
How can they approach this?
So here's the other thing that goes through my mind right before the response in whoever's delivering it, right, whatever party, is that oftentimes those are very, very memorable. These speeches have a way of providing us some really meme-worthy moments from time to time. Did anything stand out to you as potentially meme-worthy? Real quick, before we go.
I would say certainly to me the moment when President Trump pointed to the historic number of women in Congress and you had a lot of Democrats, women dressed in all white, who were standing up and cheering, pointing themselves, saying, "Yeah, that's me. I'm in Congress." That moment stood out.
I've got a job. I've got a new job. That's me. When the Speaker of the House, the new Speaker of the House, was supposed to introduce the president at the beginning of the speech, as all speakers do, and he just began the speech and she didn't do it.
Oh, is that right?
That is what happened. And so you could see the look on her face where she was ready to, like, the speaker introduces the president. But the president just turned and started.
He went with the speech.
He just went with it. That's how it went.
We'll see if any of those make it into the Twitterverse or beyond with appropriate captions. Hey, you guys have had really long days and really long nights.
And you
still have a lot of work to do. So we'll look forward to that. Lisa Desjardins and Dan Bush, thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Thanks, of course, to all of you for listening in as well. Hey, if you like this show, you're going to love our regular daily and weekly NewsHour podcasts. Listen and subscribe on our website, pbs.org/newshour, or anywhere you listen to podcasts. Also, you can follow us on Twitter. We are at NewsHour. Tweet us, let us know what you thought of the show and what else you want to see. Before we go, quick round of thanks for our incredible team that includes Vika Aronson, Travis Dobb, Vanessa Dennis, Erica R. Hendry, and James Williams. Sarah Just is our executive producer, and a special thanks to Dan Cooney, Beth Summers, Dima Zane, James Blue, Dan Devaney, and Charles Lawson from WETA-FM. I am Amna Nawaz. Thank you guys for listening.